glad they hired me. Clyde and I went back before the Missourinet a couple of years. He was a graduate student at the University of Missouri, and he was doing some work for the Missouri Broadcasters Association. The MBA had Clyde come down in the afternoons when the legislative session was underway, and he was to go to the Associated Press and get some copy from the AP about what had happened that day. Then he was supposed to go down to the broadcast center that the MBA had, and he was supposed to read that copy into a codaphone. Now, a codaphone is a telephone device that you record into, and then radio stations can call that number and get the recording of what you have read to them. Well, Clyde wanted to do a little bit more than that. Clyde started putting actuality, sound bites on there, in addition to reading a story, so the station could have even more. Well, the executive director of the Missouri Broadcasters Association didn't want him to do that much. He just wanted him to do this one thing, so he fired him. I just happened to have an opening on my staff at KLIK, a radio station that used to serve Jefferson City, and so I hired Clyde. And he and I worked together at KLIK for a couple of years before Clyde decided that $95 a week, or whatever it was he was earning, was not enough to support him and his growing family. So he quit, went to work for Buell Backley, who had the lumber yard here in town, and he was selling pavement sealer, driveway sealing material for Buell. But during the time that Clyde had been at the radio station, he and Brownfield, Derry Brownfield, had become good friends. Derry was the farm director there. And Derry had always had a dream about doing a farm network, a broadcast of farm news and stuff. And so they carried that idea after he left Click, after Clyde left Click. And they decided they would go ahead and form it. They were going to use KLIK's FM subcarrier to distribute the programs. And they started going around talking to some people about the possibilities of signing up for this. And they were going to talk to the manager of KLIK first, later on, about that once they got the thing put together. He got wind of it before they were ready to talk to him. He lived just down the street from Clyde, and he summoned Clyde to a meeting under a light post one Sunday night in their neighborhood, and was just furious. Fired Derry Brownfield the next day as the KLIK farm director and would have nothing more to do with the network. Well, they went ahead and put their network together and started doing broadcasts from a house next to the lumber yard. Derry did the programs, Clyde did the selling and everything else. And then 2 years after that was put together, they had enough money that they could put the news network on. By then, I had been entertaining thoughts of going to St. Louis to go to work for KMOX after Bob Hyland, who was the big dog there, the vice president of CBS Regional Radio, had told me that as soon as they had an opening, they wanted to bring me in. Well, apparently they never had an opening, but I found out that Hyland had told people that before. And so when I gave up on KMOX, I told Clyde, sure, I'll go ahead. So on November the 1st, 1974, I went to work for what was then the Missouri Network Incorporated, which was a farm network broadcasting. I thought that first day that I would be able to sleep in a little bit after being the morning man at KLIK all these years. But that was when Derry Brownfield decided he was going to go to Rome to cover the World Food Conference. And so my first broadcasts with the company were farm news on what now is the Brownfield Network, while Derry was in Rome. And so I did the farm news, Don Osborne did the markets, which was good because I couldn't do markets. I wouldn't know a pork belly if it sat in my lap. And so I did the news for a week, and then I set about with Clyde to start putting together the Missouri Net. And December the 1st, we brought in our first employees, and we spent that month getting everything put together and getting ourselves known in the capital and doing other things. And January 2nd, 1975, we went on to the first newscast. Between those that we've met and interviewed and those that we've covered, not just legislators, sure, but the people who come in and testify at these committee hearings, one who comes to mind right away is Joe Cruzan. Joe Cruzan's daughter, Nancy, was in an automobile accident and was left brain dead. And her case became one of the landmark cases in right-to-die legislation in the country. If someone is in a persistent vegetative state, do they have to be kept alive artificially when their brain no longer functions, when the only thing that's keeping them alive, in effect, are intravenous tubes and artificial means of breathing? So that case went all the way to the United States Supreme Court. It was one of a two or three cases that filtered up to the court about that time, defining this whole situation as what you do with someone who has not left an advance directive. And it was out of this that the whole concept of advance directives finally made it into our law. And I remember Joe Cruzan testifying before a committee. In fact, I think we still have the cassette of his testimony about what a terrible tragedy this has been for their family. And eventually Nancy was at the Mount Vernon Hospital, State Hospital. And the decision finally came down that allowed them to withdraw life support from her. I got a call one morning, just before one of our newscasts, from a group that was protesting the plans to withdraw life support. And they wanted me to know that they were planning on going to Mount Vernon and going into the hospital and plugging her back in. So I called the hospital administrator and I said, did you know that this group plans to come down there and plans to get into the hospital and reattach things for Nancy Cruzan? He did not know that at that time. So they had police and highway patrolmen there ready when this group showed up. And the attorney for the family has since written a couple of books on the right to die. And I'm in one of those books for having called the hospital. I wasn't calling to warn them so much. I was calling to find out the second part of the news story. First part I had, this group's going there. The second part is, there's a hospital aware and ready for them. And so I wound up telling them something rather than getting a news story, which is my main focus. So I had both sides of the story, but I wound up informing them of something they didn't know, so they were ready. Yeah, I felt that constantly. There's a saying that journalists write the first draft of history. And so I was always aware of that, because I've always been kind of a historian. And so I was always aware that what I was watching was history being made. I was watching, and I've gone back through in the legislative library, I've pulled down the volumes of legislative journals going back to the 1840s, you know, just kind of thumbing through them from time to time. So I have a concept or a feeling that the legislature in these 40 years I've covered it has just been continuing this historical development, this historical line that started out in 1820 with the first General Assembly in Missouri. And the journals that I've looked through from time to time, the 1840s, and you see the names of people who are senators or representatives who later went on to become governors and U.S. senators and things like that. So you get a real feel for the thread of history that way. So I've always felt, as I watched the General Assembly, in one way or another, I was watching the thread of history being played out for those times. State politics changed abruptly with the passage of term limits. It took a few years for term limits to fully kick in, but now we've lived with term limits for quite some time, and we can see the difference that has occurred between the term limits that we have now and pre-term limit times. And I'm one of those who believes that term limits is one of the worst things that's happened in Missouri politics. And I don't say that because a different party has gained control of the legislature after term limits. I don't know that term limits really is the determining factor in who's in control, but I've seen great internal problems within the General Assembly since that time, since term limits took over. The idea was that term limits will get the old people out, the old crooks out, and get the new, fresh ideas in. Well, I'm not sure that that's valid. It has removed a lot of important institutional memory from the General Assembly. It has removed a lot of people who knew how to write the laws, who knew how to write amendments. And we now have people who year in and year out have to go back and correct something that they wrote in a law the year before. We have a legislature that is regularly passing bills that members know will have to be decided by the judges. We'll pass it and let the courts figure it out. I've heard that far too many times. Since term limits came in, the critics of term limits said that if you pass term limits, the only institutional memory will be among the state employees and the lobbyists in the hallways, and you'll be turning over control of the legislature to them. And I've seen that happen. When term limits fully kicked in was when I first started hearing one member of the legislature debating a bill with another member of the legislature ask about an amendment. Have you run this amendment past so-and-so out in the hall to see if it's okay? Never used to see that. Now I've seen it. I don't see it so much now because the members of the legislature have their cell phones in their hands and they are looking at messages as they debate. The cell phone now has allowed the lobbyists to come into that chamber. So what happens in the chamber is not shaped by what's going on in the chamber and the people in the chamber. It's being dictated or at least commented on by the people in the hallway now, more than ever before that I've known it. Lobbyists have always been influential. The lobbyists have always had members of the legislature who would write bills for them or introduce amendments for them. But we've never before term limits came around, did I see one legislator ask another legislator if it was okay to adopt an amendment because somebody out in the hallway wanted it done. That to me is a telling point about what term limits has done to the legislature. And technology has done to the legislature. That plus the passage of a bill several years ago that Senator Charlie Shields of St. Joseph sponsored, as I recall, that removed all limits on campaign donations. The idea being behind that bill that if you report the donations to the Ethics Commission, then people will know who's funneling. Well, Mr. and Mrs. Joe Sixpack don't look at the Ethics Commission. They look at what those of us who report the Ethics Commission filings talk about. But they don't really see the kinds of money that is flowing around in campaigns right now. Unlimited amounts of money can be donated. Unlimited amounts of money can be spent by people who do not have to reveal where they get their money. The independent political action committees don't have to report who the donors are. And so we have these independent committees that are running commercials and ads throughout campaigns, and we don't know where their money comes from. Well, the state law allows that, and that state law could be changed as it was changed to allow all of this before. But there seems to be a certain reluctance by the people who accept this money and benefit from these ads to make those changes. So those are a couple of the things that have happened that I think have been bad for state government, because they've allowed single-issue candidates, single-issue legislators, and single-issue pressure to be leaned on, to be applied to the legislators. All of these things have happened since term limits came in, and I think that's been very bad for the state of Missouri and for its people. What I continue to see, and I've seen this throughout the 40 years I've covered the legislature, is I see decent people who come to Jefferson City with ideals, and they are quickly absorbed in the system, and they become part of that system, no matter what their goals were when they were running for office when they first came down here. I'm an optimist. I place great belief in the people. I believe that the people ultimately will make the right decisions. Things might happen before they make those decisions, because enough people have to be alarmed about something before they do something about it. It's only natural. You and I are not going to do things ourselves unless something happens in our backyard that hits us personally, and then we're going to become alarmed and we'll want to change something. Well, that's kind of the way things are. I believe people ultimately will make the proper decisions to correct any swings too far to the right or to the left.
Can the system still respond to those kinds of concerns?
I think the people will make the system respond to it one way or another. Now, it might be a while yet before there is a more centered approach to state government than there once was, I think. But I think the people, the public, will eventually reach a point where there are enough alarm bells going off on enough different subjects to apply to make a broad constituency that brings about some concerns that make some changes. So I have great confidence in the people that they ultimately will find a way to correct some of the things that I've just been talking about. So I believe in the people of Missouri. The Jerry Litton plane crash in 1976 and the Mel Carnahan plane crash in 2000, both of which altered the political landscape of the state of Missouri. Let's go back to Jerry Litton, 1976. Jerry Litton was a charismatic Democratic congressman from Chillicothe. He had his eyes on the White House. There was no doubt. I have a good friend who worked in his campaign, who was in high school about that time, who worked in the campaign, and he heard Litton say that he wanted to be the president. Litton ran for the Senate in 1976 when Stuart Symington retired. He ran as a Democrat in a field that also included Symington's son and former Governor Warren Hearns. He was running against the anticipated Republican nominee, John Danforth. Danforth was wealthy, came across as very sincere on his television ads, was very effective. But Litton spent almost all of his liquidity, 96% of his personal liquidity, and he won the Democratic nomination to run against Danforth. On the night that he won, he got on an airplane in Chillicothe to fly to a victory party in Kansas City. The plane crashed on takeoff and killed Jerry Litton and his entire family. The Democrats wound up nominating Warren Hearns, the former governor, to take his place. Danforth won easily, and that began a major turnaround politically in Missouri, because Danforth had been attorney general, and out of the attorney general's office was kind of an incubator for Republican candidates of the future, people like Christopher Bond and John Ashcroft were disciples of John Danforth. And so Danforth became a very influential Republican in Missouri. But if Jerry Litton would have beaten him then, whether Danforth's influence would have been continued to be felt within the Republican Party, I don't know. I talked to one of his top campaign aides after the election, and Alex Nechvolodoff was his name. And Alex told me that Danforth was not sure he could have beaten Litton. Danforth, I think, as I recall it, was adhering to some kind of a campaign spending limit, personally imposed. Litton would not. Although Litton had spent a lot of his money in the primary, he had the capability of raising huge amounts of money. He also was more media savvy than any politician of his time. And so he was able to reach out to people and come across as a genuine, down-home, folksy, common-sense guy. And so Danforth doubted, it says Nechvolodoff, had his doubts that he could have won that race.
Do we still feel the ripples of an event like that?
Well, we feel them because of the things that happened in that era, say from 1976 to 1980 or so. Had Jerry Litton won, Jerry Litton would have been the titular leader of the Democratic Party in the state of Missouri. And there might be some questions about whether the rise to power that occurred with the Ashcroft governorship and so on would have been nipped in the bud at that stage, and what that would have meant long term. So yes, there are ripples. And they're kind of similar to the ripples that we saw with the Carnahan crash in 2000. Mel Carnahan was running against John Ashcroft for the U.S. Senate. Ashcroft was seeking re-election. Carnahan was a very popular governor coming off his second term. His plane went down 3 weeks before the election. I talked to the man who had hosted a fundraising party for Carnahan in St. Louis just before Carnahan got back on the plane to fly to a fundraiser in southeast Missouri for a flight that was never completed. But the fellow said that Carnahan at that party, for the first time, told his supporter that the polls were showing he had inched ahead of Ashcroft. And so this plane crash happened. Had Carnahan survived, had Carnahan won and served a full 6-year term, Missouri politics would have been much different. What happened was that Jean Carnahan, his widow, was appointed by Roger Wilson to take his place in the Senate. Under those circumstances, the next time an election came around in 2 years, she had to run for a full term. She lost that election to Jim Talent. That election would not have happened if Mel Carnahan had won that race. The whole Jim Talent, Claire McCaskill, Bob Holden, all of that and all of those ripples connected to those things would have been much different if Mel Carnahan had survived and, in fact, if he had lived to serve out a full Senate term. So all of those things happened. And all of those things altered Missouri politics, Republican as well as Democrats. You can do a lot of iffy history talking here, but I don't think there's any doubt that the loss of these two very strong Democrat Party leaders changed Missouri politics. Now that I think about 40 years and I think of all the things that we've seen and done and reported on, and I look back at the names of the reporters who've been here and what some of them are doing now, I'm conscious of the passage of that time. Broadcast news is traditionally a gypsy business. The average term for a news director at a radio station is about 2 years. And it's about the same for somebody in television. I fortunately have been in a situation where I've been in a job that's been an interesting job to have. I've worked for good people. Instead of having to move to seek a larger market, I've worked for a company that has developed its own larger market as time has gone by. I've had the chance to write some books. I've had the chance to extend some pretty deep roots. I've had the chance to become kind of well-known in some quarters, which is satisfying. I didn't have to move somewhere to seek that out. I've worked for a company that paid me pretty well, so I've been able to afford to send my kids to college and live in a nice house and drive nice cars. And I've had an extremely tolerant wife all during all of this time. So I've never really entertained many thoughts about ever moving on. This has been exciting enough and entertaining enough and absorbing enough and rewarding enough. There's no reason for me to go.
So this begs the question, why now?
Why now? Well, I'm tired. You look around sooner or later, and you know this, you start thinking, there's an awful lot of stuff I want to do that I can't do when I'm working 60 or 70 or 80 hours a week. I don't want to have to work holidays. I don't want to work on weekends. I don't want to have to come up with a story to put together before I go home in the afternoons that I can run tomorrow morning. It will be a fresh news story. I just have too many other places I want to go and too many other things I want to do. And I'm at the point now where I'm secure enough financially that I can do it. And it's just time to pass it on to a new generation, which is another thing too, because technology has changed. The way we gather and present news has changed. And while I'm not saying I'm too old a dog to learn new tricks, it's just time for a new generation that has been raised in this kind of a climate, who can deal with it appropriately and properly and responsibly, to be able to do that. And I just think that the next generation is here, and it's their time, it's their opportunity. Well, I have seen a lot of changes, technologically primarily. That's a lot of it is technical. When we started, we had in our newsroom, we had one reel-to-reel recorder and one cart machine and three Sony 110B cassette recorders, and that's what we started with. We used Royal Manual typewriters. I've also seen what is to me a dismaying trend that the FCC has allowed to have happen, and that they're very large corporations that now control a great amount of radio stations in this country. And in the process, they've killed local news. Radio stations, well, I think I've put it this way. I think that radio started losing its soul when communities became markets, when radio stations became property, and when staff became human resources. Because I knew from the fourth grade that I wanted to be a journalist. And I've been able to be that, do that. If I hadn't been that, I suppose my education would have taken a different angle. And who knows what the motivation would have been at that when I was young like that. I'd like to think now, maybe looking back over what I've been interested in and the things I've followed, that maybe I would have made a pretty good lawyer. I might have gone into archaeology because I've enjoyed my archaeological trips out west sometimes. But beyond that, I don't really have the slightest idea, because I'm doing what I wanted to do since I was 9. And I can't think of anything I would rather have done with my life than to have done what I've been doing, to be what I've been. And I think a lot of people never get a chance to say that. And a lot of people just get up in the morning and go to a job. And I don't. I get up in the morning and I'm a journalist. And that's been just about the greatest thing in the world.